No, we're not. Okay, so we're going to talk about combining atoms, and that's where we get our alloys. Okay? And the brass is an example of a metal mixture. We mixed zinc and what else?
Copper.
Zinc and copper. We coated it with zinc, we put it over the copper, we heated it up, and we made the brass. Okay? So that's kind of, those metals, they mix evenly throughout that solution. Actually, it's a metal solution is what it is. So we're going to look at some different metal alloys that you might see and the reasons why we have those metal alloys. Okay? So an alloy is a solid combination of two or more metals. So it's a solid combination, two or more metals. So when we had the brass that we made, the brass penny, that's a solid combination. So lots of different alloys. Okay, lots of different metal solutions. These are considered homogeneous. They're also called solutions. And homogeneous means that when you would cut into a metal and look at it throughout the whole piece, you have an equal distribution of those atoms. Those atoms are evenly distributed throughout. And so that's in the first section, we talked about mixtures. There's two types of mixtures. There's homogeneous and then there's heterogeneous. Homogeneous just means there's equal distribution of those atoms that make it up. So if we have brass, now they could be different percentages, right? They're in your book, they'll say you have a red brass. I think there was somebody, I don't know if it was in this class or that other class, they actually, when they heated it up, it turned red. The penny turned red.
That's a thing?
Yep, that actually happened. Okay, so that would be red brass. So it's just a different combination. It probably had a lot more copper than zinc. It probably was coated just with a little bit of zinc, not much copper, and when it was heated up, it was mostly copper, so it was called red brass. Okay, but you can have like a yellow brass, you can have something a little bit more in between those two, and it depends upon how much you have of each substance, percentage-wise. Okay? We're not going to give those percentages on here. We're just going to go ahead and show the mixtures. So, for example, you guys don't have to write all that down if you don't want to. That's just what happened when we made a gold penny. So, on the test, if you have to say, well, how is brass made? You could say, well, take a penny, coat it with zinc, heat it up in a flame, and it'll cause zinc and copper to mix evenly to produce brass. So that's one way you could do it. Okay, another way you could do it, you don't have to know this, but you can grind up the copper into really small, like powder, okay, or small granules, and then you can grind up the zinc into small granules. And then what you can do is you can melt the two together. When you melt the two together, then that creates that liquid, and that liquid can be poured into molds or, you know, whatever you need to do in which to get that produced, you could do it that way. So there's that would be one way to make it. It was kind of the yellow. Some of yours was more yellow tint than a gold tint, and it's because probably it was just a different percentage of zinc. Maybe it coated the penny a lot with zinc, maybe it didn't coat it with much. So it's kind of a varying degree of yellow or gold that you'd have on those. Okay? Alright, so here's some of the different alloys that we want to take a look at. Okay? You don't have to rewrite the combining atoms part. Many materials made of metals are made up of alloys. Okay? Why alloys? Makes the weak and light metal stronger. So if you got a metal like aluminum that's pretty weak, it's very malleable, it won't hold a lot. You can mix it with a metal that's stronger And when you mix it with a metal that's stronger, then you make it less corrosive and stronger metal. So why do we want alloys? Well, you can take those light metals, add a little bit of another metal that's strong, and it creates something much stronger than in the original form. So you can make the weak stronger. So it says, should say, make weak and light metal stronger. Not A, but make weak and light metal stronger. Make brittle metals more malleable. So for example, iron by itself is brittle, or it can be a little bit more brittle than steel. So iron in itself is kind of brittle, and what we can do is we can put a little bit of carbon with it and make it stronger and make it more malleable, okay, less corrosive. We don't usually use iron just to use iron. We combine it with carbon. When you combine it with carbon, you make steel. Steel is strong, okay? But also, it's not as corrosive. So you make metals that are less corrosive. So iron by itself, you leave it out, it's going to rust. We already know kind of what rust looks like. We did some experiments where we had some metal rust. If you have it in steel, it's probably less corrosive. You're not going to have to deal with that as much. It still probably will do it over maybe a longer period of time. And sometimes we do it to increase and lower the melting points. For example, if we have ball bearings that need to be made of iron, they might cobalt you might put with it. And so with ball bearings, they might heat up because of friction, and so you need to increase their melting point. Later on, we'll look at lowering melting points, like for soldering. Has anybody ever solder in here before? Okay?
Isn't solder. That when you lay down grass?
What's that?
Isn't that when you lay down grass?
No.
Sod.
Oh.
Solder is when you take a metal and you got copper fittings, and what you do is you heat that metal up with a propane torch and then, or a little electric. Yeah, soldering iron, and then what it'll do is it'll melt it, and then before too long, if you let it cool, it solidifies and kind of seals up whatever you need to seal up. Okay, so that's called solder, and there's two types of solder we're going to take a look at. So why do we have alloys? Those are the reasons. Make weak and light metals stronger, make brittle metals more malleable, make metals less corrosive, and increase or lower the melting points, depending upon what you want to do. So, we already gave you one. It's a copper alloy and it's brass. Yeah, a lot of times, brass is a metal that is pleasing. I mean, a lot of times in cabinets, you'll have doorknobs. The knobs on the cabinets made of brass. Doorknobs made of brass. Kind of a decorative look. Light fixtures, if you have a chandelier. Okay? But that could be coated with brass. A lot of times if you go get, you have putting something together, the screws, if it's a like a ceiling fan, that's the outer portion is brass, and then you go ahead and use screws that are made of brass. So some of those are coated, and some of them are equal all the way throughout. Yes?
Is brass expensive? Because, like, aren't chandeliers expensive?
Well, they can be, depending upon, you know, what else is included there. But, no, brass, the reason why brass is inexpensive because zinc and copper are relatively inexpensive, especially zinc, relatively inexpensive. You get a good outcome, something that looks gold, looks expensive, that really is not. Okay? Bronze, you win the bronze medal, third place, right? Okay? Bronze is a mixture of copper and tin. Where brass is copper and zinc, bronze is copper and tin. So it's kind of decorative too. It's kind of like an antique, you know, look to it. If something's bronze, it kind of has a reddish brown color. So copper and tin would be another type of alloy. A lot of times bronze is used when you want to have something stronger or harder, like bearings, machine parts, metals, gunmetal. Gunmetal, the stock, not the stock, but the barrel itself is made up of a lot of copper. Okay, and copper is not corrosive. We know by doing labs that we realize copper is lower on the reactivity list, and so it's going to not rust, it's not going to corrode. It is a higher melting point metal. So what we mean by gunmetal is that it's used for that barrel, and it's a lot of copper associated with that. 97%, I think. And then they mix some other metals in there. Okay? So bronze would be a mixture of some of those things that you see there. So what we have up to this time, we have brass, we have bronze. Okay? We're going to look at steel here in a second. There's a couple different types of steel that we want to look at. Any of these I can go back to later on. So steel is a mixture of iron and carbon. Probably less than 1% carbon. So steel probably has like 99, 98% iron. Okay? But carbon, it has like 1% or less than 1%. Okay? And when they did that, Carnegie was the guy that kind of came up with the idea of steel and how steel can be formed. Okay? Okay, let me make sure you're not on your phone.
Okay.
You probably did in history. He is one of the individuals that became very wealthy, kind of had a monopoly on making steel, but that allowed skyscrapers in which to be built, like in New York City and some of the bigger towns, so they wouldn't have to spread out. Okay? So we have high carbon steel, meaning there's a lot more carbon, but it's going to be brittle. It's going to be more brittle, but it's going to be hard and resistant to bending. Okay? Kind of like if you have some I-beams, probably going to be made out of a high carbon steel. Okay? Low carbon steel is steel that's not as much carbon, and there's a lot more you can do with it when you talk about welding and molding in the shapes. Okay, bending in the shapes. So that's not as much carbon, so it's more malleable. The more carbon is going to be harder strength-wise, but you can't really mold it once it's formed very well. Okay, it's going to be more brittle. Okay? Low carbon steel, you look at automobile parts, kitchen utensils, forks, knives, those type of things, plumbing associated with that. And then a third type of one is stainless steel. This is pretty expensive because of the chromium. Chromium's a more expensive metal. So they mix it with chromium, and it's something that can sit out in the elements for a long period of time and not corrode. Okay? Not break down. So steel is so we got brass, it's a mixture of zinc and copper. We got bronze, mixture of tin and copper. We have steel, mixture of iron and carbon, and different amounts of carbon. And then stainless steel, we have, it's going to be, you know, anything. If you go to a hardware store and you get anything stainless steel, you're going to pay a lot more money for it. Okay? And it probably is going to be something used outside or used where water is prevalent. Okay. Pewter. You guys know what pewter is? They used to use this a long time ago. And now it's more, things are made out of glass. And more than pewter. Pewter, I remember when I went to the fair, Billings, Montana. We'd go to the fair. It was always in August before school started. And they'd have this game where you would shoot water into this opening. And then your racehorse would go along. Okay? And And that racehorse would go. And then what would happen is every time you won, you got a little miniature horse. And then you play again, of course, you get a bigger version of that horse.
For serious, I always got those little rubber ducks. That's not fair.
So then what happened was I just kept on getting larger and larger. I think we ended up with getting one about that size. But that was made out of this pewter. It's something that's not very strong. Very inexpensive. So if it's something that's metal and you drop it and it breaks apart real easy, then it's probably made out of that. So a lot of figurines, a lot of things that aren't glass, it looks kind of have a metal look to it, is going to be of that type. So there's probably not much of that anymore. It's brittle and light. Okay? Pewter.
Like light and weight or like light and
weight? Light and weight. Light and weight. Now, you guys probably don't have fillings that are amalgams, mercury amalgams, because it has mercury in it. You don't want to have mercury involved. You don't want to be around mercury. You don't want to touch mercury. But I have some fillings that would be amalgams. What they do is they mix in mercury. Mercury is a pretty low melting point. Well, no melting point because it's a liquid at room temperature, in with another metal, and it's very mold, you can mold it and melt it pretty quick and easy. So if you have a filling where they drill down into your tooth and then they put a filling on there that's not like porcelain, like now they have a lot of it's porcelain, so because it looks like a tooth, it doesn't stand out. But if you're older, like me, then you're going to have some fillings that have a silver look to them. It's because it's mercury amalgams.
I've written it out on the left side.
What's
that? I've written it out on the left
side. Eating. You did it yourself?
Yeah.
Why?
Got in the one in there.
Okay. All right. So, they can be dental fillings there. Anybody got any 14 karat gold here? You do?
No.
I do.
Do you really?
I have white gold.
White gold, good. I don't have that on here, but that's also white gold. Is a lot of silver, a little bit less gold. This would be 14 karat gold. They'll even say.
Is it cheaper? Is white gold cheaper?
I don't know if it's cheaper. If it has less gold in it.
My necklace is like 180.
I think it's got silver in it, which is inexpensive. But this will say 14K. Okay, so 14K is just tells you the percentage of gold. 24K is 100% gold. Okay, so if you got 24% gold, that's 100% gold. One thing about gold, if it's 100%, it's very soft. It's very malleable.
You want to know something?
What?
Do you know the Kardashians?
Yes, I know the Kardashians.
Okay, Kylie, she's like what? Probably graduating from high school. She had six. Bracelets and each of them were $6,000. It's like a whole college tuition.
Yeah. Probably have more. Probably have some things that are even more than that. So 14 karat would probably be about 60% gold. So this is about 60% gold. And the rest of it's going to be a mixture of some copper, might be some silver in there, but it's like kind of a white type of gold. But the reason why they have to put another metal in there is like those reasons. That's not one of the reasons less expensive, but the other reason it makes it more is stronger. Because if this is pure gold, it wouldn't work. Because it's too malleable. It would bend too easy. Okay? So they have to put it with other metals. Not right now. No, they're gonna have to wait. Okay? Sterling silver. So anybody in the house, you guys have sterling silver. Okay? Is that your nice utensil to get it out for like Christmas and Thanksgiving? What's that? You do? What? And what did they attach it? I mean, what's the reason? Is it rod or is it?
It's
of sterling silver that they said? Probably not a lot of corrosion that goes with it over a period of time. So, sterling silver would be a mixture of silver and copper. A lot of times, medical tools, he's talking about an insert. Sometimes they got titanium is used, but it could be sterling silver, maybe. Jewelry. You guys know what cutlery? I can't even say it.
Cutlery.
Yes. What is it?
Knives.
Okay, and sharpen them. And there's some stuff that's really expensive out there that you'd have to use. Okay, we're almost through these. Just got a couple more. We have sprinklers in the room, and there's water that's in the pipes. Okay? So this would be a sprinkler. There's water in the pipes. There's a plug. That plug is made up of probably Wood's metal. And Wood's metal is a combination of bismuth and lead. Now, lead has a pretty low melting point. And bismuth does too. So they'll put that in there, and then what happens, as the temperature would rise on those pipes where they would get hot, it wouldn't be smoke that would set them off, but when they get hot, that metal will melt in that pipe, that plug.
When it would
melt, then it would let the water through. It's kind of like a valve. And it's associated with heat. So if it heats up, it's going to heat that metal up and then melt. And then the last one is solder. Solder has a low melting point. So if you have a soldering iron or you've got a propane torch, the old solder had lead in it. They're going away from that. The lead is something that, once it heats up, it could evaporate in the air and you could breathe it in. And it's not good to breathe in that metal and get that in your system. So if you've got kind of an older solder, that if you got it home and you're looking at some of these old toolboxes and that, it could be some solder that maybe you wouldn't want to use because it has lead in it. And then the newer solders, and I don't think they work as probably as good because lead's very good because it has a lower melting point, probably works a lot better. But the new solder would have tin and copper. All right, the last thing we're going to talk about is some things dealing with non-renewable and renewable resources real quick. So a non-renewable resource, all these metals are non-renewable resources. You cannot make those. Nature doesn't make those metals. Okay? Once they're made, and we have them made into product, we're either going to have to recycle them or find places we can dig in which to get more of those ores with those metals in them. Okay? That would be an example of a non-renewable resource. Renewable resource would be, for example, plants that grow every year, like in Nebraska, it's huge to our economy. Renewable resources are maintained indefinitely if they're used wisely, okay? If we don't overdo it. Like, for example, the forests that are in Oregon, in Washington, some places, they overlog them, and they overuse that area, and so they kind of regulate that, and they take a few in this area and this area so that trees, and then replant trees so that over the next 80 years, you go back to that area and get those resources back again. Okay? So water, definitely renewable, right? Here's the water cycle that you guys learned probably in sixth grade. We have water evaporates, goes in the clouds. We get that rain. Rain goes in the ground. Maybe forms lakes or ponds. Then those rivers eventually will end up back at the ocean. And water evaporates again. Rains, that cycle. Okay, that water cycle. Every time it evaporates, it's kind of cleaning itself. Okay? kind of cleaning. Pure water is pure water when it evaporates. Leaves behind a lot of the junk that's dissolved in it. Okay? So it's kind of like distilling. Nature's distilling it. So that's the water cycle. Water cycle. Water is very renewable. Sometimes we have to filter out some things that our plant in Beatrice, we have to filter out some things that could be harmful that's dissolved in there. But the water that goes in the drain back through the sewer and that, we can reclaim that. Okay, it can evaporate off. It can be clean. Air is definitely something that's renewable because plants will use the CO2 and then we use the oxygen and we give off CO2. All animals are going to go through that process. So oxygen and CO2, renewable. Plants, of course, animals, regeneration, anything that can regenerate plants and animals, those are going to be new renewable resources. Something very important in the economy in Nebraska is the idea called ethanol. We got ethanol plants where we'll have grain trucks that will go there and get paid for their grain, and then that grain is used to produce ethanol, which can be blended with gasoline. Also, a lot of that corn can be used for food for animals. Okay, we have the stocks now that are left behind. We've got a plant that's going to employ hopefully 80-100 people, and that's the biodiesel plant that they're working on. Okay, and they're trying to take everything of that corn plant, the stocks, and what's left behind, and use that in which to make biodiesel fuel. Okay. So they're trying to, they're trying to use everything in that corn to make use of it. You got non-renewable resources, they cannot be readily replenished. Coal, petroleum, your oil, your natural gas, of course, are metals we've been talking about. There's a real push to go away from coal because it's not a clean burning fuel, but if you go away from coal, your bills that you get from City of Beatrice are going to be higher. We have some wind's a renewable resource and that can supplement it, but the cost associated with that, how much it gives off, we'll have to wait and see. But if it is a strict go away from coal and not burn it anymore, you're going to have to be paying out more money to be able to use that energy in your home. What's that?
Petroleum.
Petroleum is just oil. Just an oil. Oil is just a mixture of a lot of different substances. Okay? So this is the last. We want to get this done before you go today. There's four R's. You need to rethink, reuse, reduce, recycle. We want to look at ways we do rethink old methods. Like the government has set miles per gallon that vehicles get. That's rethinking. Looking at more efficient vehicles that don't use as much gasoline. Okay? So that's a rethinking process. Instead of a truck like mine, that was built, around 2000, it gets about 15 or 16 miles a gallon. These new trucks, of course, they're really, really expensive. I don't know how you can afford them, but, they're probably getting up around 27 to a gallon.
No way.
Yeah.
Okay, this one guy, he comes into my work every night with his best friend, and he gets coffee or whatever, but he has this, little car. It's not, an electric car, but he gets, 40
yeah.
On the highway and 32 in town.
Right. So that's that rethinking.
Yeah.
Reusing would be maybe your mom now, or maybe you go to the grocery store and you have that bag. Instead of getting the plastic, you go in with those four or five bags and you don't use the plastic bags anymore. that's kind of the idea of reusing. Something you reuse. I just put on there, there's some times that I got a friend of mine that if you take him your old oil, motor oil, he's got a furnace that he just pours the oil in there, drips in there, and it burns. Burns the oil. I think we do that out here, don't we? Yeah? Okay, guys, we're not done yet. No, you're not going yet. Okay, we're going to finish up, Brennan. Okay, there's only two more of these. What's that? Okay. Brennan, you're not supposed to go anywhere until a couple minutes before we... So we got a couple minutes left. Okay, so reusing. Reducing. For example, gasoline is a non-renewable resource. So what they'll do is they'll blend ethanol in there. Ethanol, we make that. We got about 10% ethanol. It's cleaner burning. So they're substitutes. Okay, so when we talk about reducing, we want to substitute with renewable resources. Okay, and there's the last slide's only got the recycling part of it, and then we'll be done. Okay, so rethinking how we're going to do things to conserve what we do have, reusing, and then reducing. Okay, and recycling. Metals and plastics a lot of times are being recycled. If you go down, Beatrice has a building. It's got a lot of that stuff we can recycle. A lot of the metals, a lot of the plastics, paper products, those type of things. Here in a second. Okay? I know you do. You'll get there first in line. I know, that's people probably got to go. Awesome. Go ahead and go, Austin.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you, Norman. Such a good teacher.
Shut up.
That means I pass to you. Beat it.
He always says something. Like when he gets out of the room, like, yeah.
That's figures.
I wasn't here for this, apparently.
What's that? I think no, this you were gone. Last, yeah. Were you at SEC?
Yeah. That was last Thursday. That's kind of cool.